Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nabbing Ned Kelly, the extraordinary true story of the men who brought Australia's notorious outlaw to justice, by David Dufty. Narrated by Grant Cartwright. Publisher's note: this audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. They laughed and larked at what they'd done as from the town they turned. They rode away like brigands bold, the Kellys, Hart and Byrne. They chatter now about police and say they're not effective, but the fear of God is in their hearts of Michael Ward, detective. Corowa Free Press, 13 June, 1879. Introduction. Ned Kelly was tall, strong, good-looking, charismatic, and a formidable hand-to-hand brawler, but he was no hero. A compulsive liar, he was also paranoid and delusional. Ned was good at crime. He was the architect of a large intercolonial criminal syndicate at a time when police were unaccustomed to dealing with organized crime. He stole cattle, horses, guns and gold. He robbed banks. He murdered. And in the end, he was undone by an insane plan to commit an act of mass murder. I'm sure you've heard the legends about him, that he was an Australian Robin Hood, that the murders he committed were in self-defense, that the bank robberies and kidnappings were merely ploys to raise awareness of police injustice, that the common people supported him because he opposed greedy, rich landholders. But none of those things are true, nor are many other things said about him. The original idea for this book was to tell the story of the Kelly Gang from the police point of view. It seemed like an intriguing, exciting, and overlooked angle on a popular topic. The end result, the book you're listening to now, is still broadly in line with that vision, but it has evolved into a wider investigation of myths and lies. That wasn't the plan, but the deeper I dug, the more it became an imperative. There was already so much written and said about Kelly. It was overwhelming. How could one person possibly read it all? There have been dozens of books, as well as songs, plays, poems, documentaries, websites, and movies. But then came the realization. All those books, movies, documentaries, and so on, used the same original source material. So why not start with that? So I initially skipped past all the other books about the Kelly Gang and went right back to basics, studying the original police reports, news coverage, and the proceedings of the 1881 Police Royal Commission. Only after immersing myself in the archival sources and through them forming my own view of events, did I explore the work of others. That approach of rebuilding the story from its foundations has led me to question almost everything about the standard historical narrative about the Kelly Gang, and to counter much of what is considered to be fact. The version of events you're about to listen to here is at odds with most versions you're likely to find elsewhere. The Kelly Outbreak, as it was called at the time, was a cataclysmic event. There was saturation news coverage of everything Kelly-related for more than 2 years, from the Stringybark Creek murders in 1878 to sometime after Kelly's execution in November 1880. The news articles retained by the National Library of Australia are a goldmine of contemporary and sometimes primary sources. The public records are a wealth of data too. While many aspects of colonial life were rudimentary, Victoria was ahead of other colonies in record-keeping, and consequently, there are thousands of pages of official documents, ranging from detective reports to witness affidavits to internal memos, all in the Victorian Public Record Office. During his reign of terror, Kelly made accusations of police persecution, which gained widespread media coverage. In 1881, the Victorian government established a royal commission to investigate the causes of the Kelly outbreak and the police response. The commissioners found no evidence that Kelly or his family were persecuted. Likewise, in searching the various archives 140 years later, I didn't find any evidence of it either. The royal commission cross-examined more than 60 witnesses, and the transcripts of those cross-examinations provide fascinating first-hand accounts of events. Those stories form the backbone of this book, providing a rich cast of characters from every rung of the ladder. At the top is the police commissioner, Captain Standish, a colourful, deeply flawed character with enough redeeming features to make him likeable. Vain and inept senior officers, drunk inspectors, taciturn sergeants and constables who ranged from cowardly to courageous. And in the midst of it all is the Irish-born detective Michael Ward, unjustly portrayed as a minor villain in Kelly mythology, who was Kelly's most dogged and tenacious adversary. When I eventually delved into the subgenre known as Kellyana, I discovered that modern retellings of the Ned Kelly story don't much resemble the narrative that emerges from the archival documents. In some cases, it appears that historians have willfully distorted the historical picture. Most astonishing was my discovery that Ned Kelly himself has been used as a primary historical source. For example, most versions of the Kelly story feature Kelly's stepfather, George King, as his partner in crime for a string of robberies. That's what Ned claimed. Yet there is no mention of George King in any newspaper of the day or in archival records, other than a mention of his marriage to Ned's mother, Ellen, in 1874. The local police had not even heard of him. He seems to have just disappeared, if he existed at all. George King does not feature in this book. In one of his famous Ned Kelly series paintings, Sidney Nolan depicted Constable Fitzpatrick with his arm seductively around Ned's sister Kate, with Ned's figure seen outside through the window. Nolan commented on the historical basis of the artwork, saying, "The action looks a little comic, but it began the real trouble." Since he was an artist rather than a historian, Nolan can be forgiven for believing that falsehood. There are varying accounts of the young policeman's seduction of Kate, but they're all wrong. Not only is there no evidence for it, Ned Kelly himself denied that it happened. Fitzpatrick is a much maligned figure in the fantasy world inhabited by Kelly mythologists. Many claim that when Constable Fitzpatrick came to arrest Ned's brother Dan, he was drunk. There is no evidence for that, other than that he had a single drink earlier in the day, midway on his two-hour journey. It is also said that Fitzpatrick was an alcoholic and that he died of cirrhosis of the liver. But he wasn't, and he didn't. Ned Kelly claimed that he murdered three police at Stringybark Creek in self-defense, but the forensic evidence and the testimony of the only police survivor of the massacre comprehensively refuted that version of events. Yet Ned's version is routinely treated as historical fact. It is said that the courts had it in for him, yet the opposite was true. Browsing court reports in old newspapers, I discovered that district magistrates, either through corruption or fear, went easy on crime, using any paltry excuse to acquit. Prosecutors struggled to produce witnesses, who failed to appear or changed their testimony on the stand, or simply vanished before they had a chance to testify. There are plenty more myths. Many arise either from strange and unreliable source material, such as interviews with the children or grandchildren of people who were there, or second or third-hand memoirs that amount to nothing more than rumour and hearsay. Others arise from cherry-picked or misinterpreted quotes from the proceedings of the Royal Commission. It's appalling. I am not the first to discover the hollow heart of the Ned Kelly myth. Others have challenged the lies, but their voices have been drowned beneath the chorus of adulation for a manipulative, violent psychopath. But this is not Ned Kelly's story. This is the story of the men who tried to bring him to justice. The Days of Harry Power. 1. Magistrate McBean's Heirloom Watch. Robert McBean was a squatter and magistrate from northeastern Victoria. He owned Kilfra, a large sheep station, called a run, near the township of Benalla. He was doing reasonably well, although Kilfra's soil wasn't as fertile as that of nearby runs. He had also lost some of his land, which had been sold off by the government in small parcels known as selections, under recent land reform laws. While patrolling his property on horseback on a pleasant afternoon in March 1870, he noticed two horsemen. The older of the two, a bushranger known as Harry Power, approached McBean. The younger man held back and turned away, as if concerned that McBean would recognize him, and indeed, McBean believed he did recognize him as Ned Kelly, a young man he had seen in court a time or two. Harry Power ordered McBean to dismount. When McBean refused, Power drew a revolver, pointed it at him, and asked a second time. McBean dismounted. Power wanted cash, but McBean had none. After all, he was just riding around his own property. However, he was carrying a watch. That would do. Power told him to tie the watch to the horse's bridle. Then, after he did so, Power led the horse away. The gold watch was a cherished family heirloom and worth more than the horse. McBean was particularly aggrieved by the robbery because he believed that as a magistrate, he had cultivated a tacit understanding with the local criminals through leniency and generosity. The judiciary would go easy on well-connected, organized criminals and in turn would either get a quiet bonus or would not be targeted for crime. Their stock would not be stolen, nor would their haystacks catch fire overnight. Harry Power, whose real name was Henry Johnson, had escaped from Pentridge Prison a year earlier in February 1869. He had been serving time with hard labour for shooting a policeman and horse theft. He was also suspected of two murders, never proven. One day, while working in the prison labour gang, he lay down in a grassy hollow and waited for nightfall. When the guards escorted the other prisoners back inside the prison walls, he fled. By the time they realized he was gone, it was too late. He had scars on his right cheek, forehead and arms, and the third finger on his left hand was deformed. His feet were so diseased with bunions that he had trouble walking and needed oversized boots. Despite being easily recognized and hobbled by disease, he wasn't caught. Power headed to northeastern Victoria, to the hills and mining towns of the Ovens and Murray River catchments, where he took refuge with old mates and resumed his life of crime. Over the next year, he robbed rich and poor alike, appearing with his shotgun and shouting the infamous bushranging cry, "Bail up!" He bailed up stagecoaches, farmhouses, liquor stores, lonely travellers and itinerant workers. He set fire to a store in Gundagai, savagely beat a Chinese miner who refused to obey him, and stole a little boy's comforter at gunpoint. He boasted that he loved targeting farmhouses after the husband had gone to work and the wife was home alone. He crisscrossed the colony, sometimes committing robberies more than 100 miles distant in the space of a day. There were reports that he had a young accomplice who was initially known only by the name Lake. The identity of his accomplice had now been established by McBean as Ned Kelly, a lad who lived with his mother and several siblings on a small property near Greta, east of Benalla. Some months before he was robbed, McBean had gone to court after two of his employees had stolen and killed two of his sheep. There, he had encountered Ned Kelly. One of the thieves, Alex Gunn, was Ned Kelly's brother-in-law. The teenaged Kelly appeared as a witness for the defence, claiming he had sold Gunn the sheep. When asked what brands the sheep had, Kelly said there were no brands. Keeping a straight face, he explained it was because they were pets. Gunn was issued with a £10 fine, a slap on the wrist for a crime that attracted serious prison time. Edward Kelly, better known as Ned Kelly, was probably born in June 1855 in the colony of Victoria. His parents were both Irish. His father, John Red Kelly, had been transported to a prison in Van Diemen's Land as a convict, gained freedom, and tried to make a new life in Victoria. But he was a heavy drinker and died of alcohol-related illness when Ned was still a boy. Ned's mother, Ellen, had come to Victoria in 1841 as a child with her parents and many siblings, as free settlers. Her father, James Quinn Sr., was a hard worker and a prudent saver who had hoped his children would have a better life in Victoria than the impoverished existence they had left behind in Ireland. But it turned out that Ellen's brothers cared only for drinking and stealing cattle. It was generally said that James was an honest man, although the land he purchased, the Glenmore Run, was on the stock smuggling route through the King Valley. After Red died, Ellen had other lovers and more children. Ned fell under the influence of his criminal uncles, then took up bushranging with the notorious Harry Power. Meanwhile, a plan to end Power and Kelly's crime spree was born over drinks at an exclusive club in Melbourne. 2. The Melbourne Club. The Melbourne Club on Collins Street looks much the same today as it did in 1870. The lamp posts at the entry, the three-story brick and stucco walls, the bay windows, the basement windows below street level that peer onto the mossy servants' alley. Inside, there is still a labyrinth of hallways, entryways, bedrooms, sitting rooms, and dining rooms. Of course, there aren't stables anymore. Those are long gone, along with the servants living in the basement. But it's largely unchanged from a century and a half ago. And furthermore, it's still an exclusive men's club, restricted to men of status and wealth in Melbourne society. It was founded in 1838 by a group of 23 gentlemen, most of whom were wealthy farmers who wanted the club to provide a comfortable place for them to stay when visiting Melbourne. The membership soon expanded to include lawyers, bureaucrats, military officers, merchants, and other respectable professions. Nobody pays attention to the Melbourne Club these days. It's a historical curiosity, a quiet feature of the city that somehow resisted the sweep of progress. It has no influence and, for the most part, attracts little ire. Not like then. Not like the days when a new governor's first social engagement, after stepping ashore from England, would be to dine as guest of honour at the club, when most parliamentarians were club members, or when a Victorian premier attacked the clique or cabal who aspire through the Melbourne Club to rule the colony. But even then, its political power was exaggerated. Its membership included politicians of all political stripes, not just reactionaries, and even included that bane of squatters, Premier James McCulloch. And the club, perhaps sensitive to such criticisms, went to lengths to quash any hint of political activity behind its austere walls. Activism, including the circulating of petitions, was forbidden. Private discussions over a cigar and brandy were acceptable. Which brings us to March 1870, to a private conversation over brandy between two club members. One of them was Robert McBean. The other was Captain Frederick Standish, the Chief Commissioner of Police. McBean was telling Standish about his recent experience on his farm. In their conversation, McBean complained bitterly that Harry Power had been terrorising the northeastern towns near the Ovens River for more than a year and the police had done nothing. Why? Well, he and Standish both knew the answer to that. The police force was a shambles. Frederick Standish had been born into a wealthy upper-class English family, had mixed with royalty, and had held the rank of captain in the British Army. But he was a man of pleasure, and amassed such a colossal gambling debt that he had fled Britain for Victoria under the pseudonym F.C. Selwyn, without a penny to his name. He became a miner in Ballarat in 1852, experiencing firsthand the tyranny of the Goldfields police and bureaucrats prior to the Eureka Rebellion. Eventually, desperate for income, he dropped the pseudonym and entered the public service. He ascended quickly. The following year, he was appointed to the role of Chinese protector, a position created in response to ethnic tensions on the goldfields. Standish took to it with gusto, using his position to champion the interests of the Chinese community. On one occasion, an interracial couple, a Chinese man and a Caucasian woman, came to him for help, complaining that the local clergy had refused to conduct their wedding. Standish conducted the ceremony himself, pronounced them man and wife, then forged the name of the town's Anglican priest on the registration document. In 1858, he was appointed as Chief Commissioner of Police and became responsible for reforming a dysfunctional service. In the earliest days of the colony, police had been recruited primarily from ex-convicts, and although that hiring practice had now ceased, many were still either former convicts or former convict guards. There had been no entry requirements until 1853, not even the ability to read and write, and no training. Alcoholism was rampant. The force had come under public and political scrutiny after the Eureka Rebellion on the Ballarat goldfield. A reformer, Standish managed the evolution of the force into a functional, respectable institution. But old habits returned. With his generous salary, he resumed gambling and drinking. His parties and all-night card games were legendary. Standish's love of pleasure was his greatest weakness and led to his greatest failing as chief commissioner. He was fond of his drinking and gambling friends, and officers who aspired to higher ranks discovered an easy pathway to promotion. Standish played favourites, and in this, his judgment was clouded. He had only partial control over promotions, which were ultimately decided by the politicians, but to the extent that he did not always choose well. The Melbourne Club became a second home to him, and indeed in 1872, 2 years after the conversation with McBean, he moved in permanently, conducting the business of running the Victorian police force from its cloistered private rooms. As the evening wore on at the Melbourne Club, a waiter dressed in blue and red livery, with gilt buttons, kept up the flow of drinks, while McBean and Standish talked over the Harry Power problem. Power must be getting local assistance, and McBean had an idea how he might discover who had been helping him. Power had served time in Pentridge with a local thief named Jack Lloyd, who had since been released. The Lloyd family were notorious criminals, and Jack Lloyd himself was married to a Quinn, which made him Ned Kelly's uncle. Lloyd probably knew who was harbouring Power. Standish proposed that Jack Lloyd could be recruited as a fizz gig, a paid informer who would share in the reward then being offered for information leading to Harry Power's capture. He proposed a plan to McBean, one that bypassed the incompetent local police. McBean was sceptical, but he really wanted his watch back. 3. The fizz gig. Under Standish's instructions, a warrant was issued for Jack Lloyd's arrest, and he was arrested on the 9th of April 1870 by two Melbourne detectives. The warrant was bogus. They arrested him for an armed hold-up near Seymour that they knew had been committed by Power. The local police were cut completely out of the loop. The next day, he was transported to Seymour lockup, awaiting a hearing. He was a captive audience for Robert McBean's proposal. McBean told Lloyd about his watch, stolen by Power, and said he wanted it back. If Lloyd was willing, he could meet McBean at Kilfera Station for further discussions. It seems he was willing, because when he appeared in Seymour Court, all charges were either dropped or dismissed. The second part of Standish's plan was to increase the reward money for the capture of Power, to make it worth Lloyd's while. Standish made the case to the Chief Secretary, who increased the reward to £500. In early May, Standish visited the police depot at the Melbourne suburb of Richmond, where he had a quiet chat with Superintendent Frank Hare. He explained the setup he had arranged with McBean and Lloyd to catch Harry Power, and asked, or rather ordered, Hare to run the operation. The Chief Secretary, James McCulloch, had directed him to place Frank Hare in charge. As Lloyd's visit to Kilfera Station was imminent, Standish told Hare to get on his way as soon as possible. He promised him that if he succeeded, he would be promoted at the next opportunity. Before parting, he gave Hare complete latitude. "I leave you to make your own arrangements and take with you whoever you please." Frank Hare was a large, tough man. He had been born in South Africa in 1830, the youngest of 20 children. He arrived in Victoria to join the gold rush in 1852. He went from Ballarat to Beechworth and then to Bright, striking luck occasionally, but mostly striking dirt. He lived rough and poor and had several run-ins with the police before throwing in his shovel and moving to Sydney, where he struggled to find work. A well-connected relative, a distant cousin named Colonel Butterworth, who was the governor of Singapore, looked him up when visiting Sydney. Butterworth pitied his sad, down-at-heel relative, so he pulled some strings and got Hare a job as a constable in the Victorian police. That was the extent of Hare's connections. He knew someone who knew someone who knew Captain Standish. He would never be a member of the Melbourne Club, enjoying port and cigars with Standish and his circle of judges and politicians. But it was enough to get a start. His experience on the goldfields helped. Whenever gold was found in a creek or river, there was a new rush. A city would grow and spread across river plains and mountain valleys like weeds, with winding mazes of tents, makeshift huts, and mine shafts. The muddy roads, carved by boots and wagon wheels, were lined with hawker carts, makeshift theatres, and grog shops. Women mostly avoided these places, but male fortune seekers, scoundrels, and dreamers flocked to them. Theft, assault, and murder were common. Riots sometimes broke out. The police were often simply engaged in crowd control. A big, burly police officer like Hare, who had been a miner himself, was ideally suited for the job. At 40, he was putting on weight and slowing down, but was still fit and strong enough for a bush ranger hunt. As Hare prepared his horse and buggy, Superintendent Charles Nicholson came to Richmond Depot. He told Hare that he knew about the mission and asked if he could come along. Head of the police district at Kyneton in the Macedon Ranges, Nicholson was currently in Melbourne on extended sick leave due to migraines and inflamed eyes. Nicholson was Scottish, 41 years old, and had come to Victoria in 1852, the same year as Hare. But he had joined the police force a year earlier than Hare, which technically made him the senior officer of the two, a fact he liked to mention. Nicholson would have been right at home in the Melbourne Club with Captain Standish, but he was not a brandy and cigar type. His wife, Helen, was the daughter of John Thomas Smith, a long-serving prominent member of Parliament and also one of Victoria's highest-ranking Freemasons. Nicholson's life was comfortable from start to finish. He had never lived in desperate poverty as Frank Hare, or Captain Standish for that matter, had done. But many years earlier, as a young policeman, he had been responsible for a stunning act of bravery. In his first year as a police cadet, he had been engaged with a small party of police in a search for some bushrangers and had come under fire. Nicholson tore up his own shirt to make a tourniquet for a colleague's wound, saving his life. Then he and his superior galloped off in pursuit and engaged the bushrangers in another gunfight. Nicholson was shot in the face. The wound left a permanent scar and gave him migraines for the rest of his life. Nicholson had an excellent work ethic, but a dour and condescending manner, perhaps exacerbated by chronic pain. He was also a snob. Standish referred to him behind his back as the cranky Scotchman. Around the 10th of May, they rode together in Hare's horse and buggy to Kilfra, where Robert McBean was expecting them. Jack Lloyd arrived. Hare spoke to Lloyd in private, then returned to tell the others the deal was off. Hare didn't trust Lloyd, and Lloyd didn't trust Hare. Nervously, McBean said, "If that be the case, what risk do I run now, having trusted and arranged with this man to take the reward?" It showed the power of the local criminal gangs that a police magistrate was worried about being a police snitch. Nicholson offered to try to win Lloyd over. He and Lloyd moved away and spoke privately. Then, when they returned, Nicholson announced that the deal was back on, with the proviso that Lloyd received all the reward money. Nicholson wrote him a memo promising him the entire £500 if he helped to catch power. The four arranged to meet again once Lloyd had made some inquiries. Only days earlier, the local police had received a tip-off that Harry Power and Ned Kelly were at Kelly's mother's shanty, having ridden overnight after committing a distant robbery. At daybreak, on the 4th of May, four police surrounded the Kelly shanty and moved in. They were led by District Superintendent Nicholas and also included Sergeant James Whelan, Constable Mullane, and Constable Arthur. Harry Power was gone, but Ned was home, so they brought him in. A crowd gathered in Benalla to see the arrested bushranger. Kelly was in a cheerful mood, smiling and nodding at familiar faces as he was taken to the Benalla lockup. The township of Benalla was quite close to McBean's Kilfra run, around 10 miles further west. Nicholson and Hare decided to take advantage of this development. They visited young Kelly in the Benalla lockup to see if he would give up power, but he wouldn't. Hare dismissed him as a flash, ill-looking young blackguard. They returned to Melbourne to wait for details about the next meeting with their phys-gig, Jack Lloyd. Ned Kelly stood trial in Benalla on the 12th of May for two separate charges of robbery. The first charge was for assisting power in the McBean robbery. Robert McBean appeared as a witness, but said that he could not identify Kelly as Power's assistant because the lad had his back to me the whole time. That case was dismissed. The second charge was for robbing a wool sorter named Joseph Bolwowski, bailed up at gunpoint as he walked home after work near Seymour. Kelly had allegedly aimed a double-barreled shotgun at Bolwowski while Power searched him, robbing Bolwowski of £5, a pistol, some powder, bullets, caps, and various other small items. The prosecutor admitted he had no witnesses. The police had made extensive inquiries, but Joseph Bolwowski had vanished. Since the victim, who was the only witness to the crime, could not be found, that case was also dismissed. Kelly was then transported to Kyneton, further south, to face a third charge of armed robbery. It was alleged that he and Power had bailed up two herdsmen named Murray and O'Leary, keeping them hostage until after dark. It has sometimes been said that Kelly was a kind of Robin Hood, but he and Power were not above robbing poor, rural working men or struggling shopkeepers. However, like Joseph Bolwowski, the Kyneton witnesses could not be found. Nicholson lived in Kyneton as he was the head of Kyneton Police District. When Kelly was transferred to the lockup there, Nicholson visited him a second time to try to get him to turn on Power. Kelly provided some useful snippets. He warned Nicholson to be careful when approaching Power's encampment because there was a hollow tree that could be used as a guardhouse, with holes in the trunk for shooting at intruders. Nicholson called it Power's watchbox. In the process of gaining information from Kelly, Nicholson must have revealed that Power's capture was imminent, because he engineered the court proceedings to retain Kelly for an extra week due to the risk that Kelly would return to warn Power. In Melbourne, Frank Hare added two personnel to the team, his clerk, Sergeant Montfort, and a black trader named Donald. He sent them to Benalla in advance, where they slept at the police barracks while awaiting instructions. The local police remained in the dark. Jack Lloyd was ready to meet. Hare sent an enciphered telegram instructing Montfort and Donald to go to Kilfera Station on Sunday, 29th of May. Hare and Nicholson arrived at the farmhouse the night before. Montfort and Donald arrived on the Sunday. A nervous Jack Lloyd was there as well. 4. It takes a thief to catch a thief. On Thursday, 2nd of June, the search party of five men left Kilfera Station. Hare, Nicholson, Montfort, Donald, and Jack Lloyd as their guide. Before they left, McBean provided £15 for Lloyd to pay Power in exchange for the gold watch. To avoid attention, they took a circuitous route through hills and forests, avoiding roads and farms. On Friday, they came to the boundary fence of the Glenmore Run. The large station on the upper reaches of the King River was the property of the Quinn family. With the death of James Quinn Sr. from dysentery a year earlier, the Glenmore Run was now held in his wife's name, but effectively under the control of his many children, Ned Kelly's aunts and uncles. James Quinn Sr. had not only worked hard, he had saved and made astute investments, but his children had not continued in the same way. The Glenmore Run remained forested and uncleared, the buildings and fences run down, its potential remained untapped. The police search party made camp in a secluded spot several miles from the farmhouse. With McBean's £15 in his pocket, Jack Lloyd left them and went to the Quinn farmhouse. The three police and the black tracker waited for his return, dining on cold provisions. Jack Lloyd returned on Saturday evening and reported success. He pulled out a small object wrapped in a handkerchief from his pocket. He opened it and showed them. It was the gold watch that Power had relinquished for the £15. Lloyd had been escorted to Harry Power's hideout to do the exchange, and could now lead them there. It was up in the ranges behind the Glenmore Run, and it could only be accessed, as far as he knew, by the gully where the Quinn farmhouse was situated. He said that on the approach to Power's hut was a hollow tree with a bed in it, although it was unoccupied. But they could not get past the farmhouse undetected because the Quinns kept dogs that would bark at intruders, sounding the alarm. There was also a large peacock that roosted on the roof, which would make a shrill cry if it saw them. Hare dismissed those concerns. As he saw it, having come so far, they had no alternative but to try. Jack Lloyd was terrified. If the Quinns saw him with the police, he would be in deep trouble. He wanted to leave, but Hare made him stay. He ran off. With Donald's help, they tracked him down. Hare threatened to shoot Lloyd if he tried to escape again. They went through the pass into the valley of the Glenmore Run, and from there travelled through an endless succession of creeks and ferns. The ride to the farmhouse seemed to take forever. Lloyd was leading them astray. They were lost. Hare asked Donald if he could take them back to where they had started. Donald simply said, "Yes, you've been going around in circles all night." He led them to the spot where they had camped, and from there to the Quinn farmhouse. As they were making plans to sneak past and into the ranges, there was a huge downpour. It was a stroke of luck. They slipped past the Quinn's farmhouse unnoticed. If they wanted to catch Harry Power, they knew they needed to find him before sunrise. But in the dark, wet forest, again Lloyd could not find his way. He broke down and cried. Hare asked Donald if he could locate the tracks that Jack Lloyd and the Quinn brothers had made the previous day. Donald set out, returning a while later to report success. He then led the way, while Lloyd hung back, miserable, and waiting for another chance to escape. It was daybreak when they found the hollow tree with the bed inside it. They scanned the cloudy sky for signs of smoke, in case Power had lit a fire, and Donald said he could tell there was a fire up along the mountain. They left Lloyd at the hollow tree, while Donald led them higher up the ridge, where they discovered a gunyah. They could see the feet of a man lying on a bed inside. The three officers rushed the gunyah, grabbed Power by the ankles, and dragged him outside. He had been fast asleep, and howled in surprise when they grabbed him. They arrested him and slapped on some handcuffs. Power asked who they were and how they got up there. "We're from Melbourne, and came past the Quinn's house," Hare told him. Power replied, "No fear, you couldn't have passed without the dogs and peacock giving the alarm." "We did pass them." They searched Power's gunyah, where they found his double-barreled shotgun slung from a pole and pointing down the hill. If he had been awake, he could easily have shot them. They were all hungry and asked him for some food. Power said, "If you go to that tree, you'll find some fine corned beef." And so they did. They also found tea, sugar, and bread in the tent. Donald said with delight, "Oh golly, what a feed we shall have." They had a hearty breakfast before taking Power back down the mountain. When they returned to the hollow tree, Jack Lloyd was gone. In the valley below, as they reached the Quinn farmhouse, the dogs barked and the peacock shrieked. The Quinns sullenly watched the procession of police ride by with Harry Power in handcuffs. Power was very talkative, relating bushranging stories as they rode to Wangaratta. The stories made his escapades sound like good, harmless fun. It was late Sunday morning, and the Wangaratta church services were all finishing. Word spread quickly, and the townsfolk hurried from church to see the famous bushranger brought into town. Power called out to bystanders, "They have got poor Power at last, but they caught him asleep." When the time came for Power's trial at Beechworth Courthouse, the three police transported him to Beechworth in Frank Hare's horse and buggy, with Power again regaling Hare with tales of his exploits. As they neared Beechworth, Power thanked Hare for treating him so well. As a gift of gratitude, he offered Hare his magnificent black mare, describing where the horse could be found in the Warby Ranges. Hare asked him where he had acquired her. Power answered, "You mustn't ask me that question." Did you get her on the square? Hare persisted. No. Then I can have nothing to do with her. They arrived in Beechworth, with Nicholson at the reins of the buggy, and Power beside him. Montfort and Hare followed on horseback. This arrangement was probably at the insistence of Nicholson, who liked to remind the others that he was the most senior of the three. A crowd had gathered near the courthouse to watch Power's arrival. He doffed his hat and bade them good morning. Harry Power was tried for robbery under arms, specifically for bailing up the Buckland coach and its passengers. He pleaded guilty and was sentenced to 15 years imprisonment. He did not face trial for any of the hundreds of other robberies and assaults he had committed. It may be that the police considered that, given his age, he was about 50, and the long sentence, there was no point in further prosecutions. He was transported to Melbourne by coach and regaled Frank Hare, who accompanied him on the journey, with yet more stories of the bush-ranging life. Hare later published much that Power had told him in his book, The Last of the Bushrangers. Harry Power was ultimately deposited back in Pentridge Prison, from where he had originally escaped. Reporters remarked on his cheerfulness, politeness, and courtesy towards his captors. 2 days before Power's capture, Ned Kelly had been released from Kyneton lockup. Journalists drew the obvious conclusion that the old bushranger had been betrayed by his protege, and Harry Power came to the same conclusion. He publicly badmouthed Ned Kelly for years. There was some truth in that. Kelly had revealed some information to Nicholson, although exactly how much is unclear, and was paid £3. Soon after returning home, Kelly wrote to Sergeant Babington in Kyneton. I would like to know what you and Mr. Nicholson would do for me. I have done all circumstances would allow me, which you now try, what you can do, answer this letter as soon as possible. Direct your letter, Daniel Kelly, Greta Post Office. That is my name, no more at present. Everyone looks on me like a black snake. Send me an answer as soon as possible. Jack Lloyd was a lucky man. Ned Kelly was the suspected fizgig, and Lloyd was in the clear. The reward money was placed in the care of a trusted person who doled it out to him in small amounts when required. 4 years later, Jack Lloyd hacked his neighbour's horse to death and was sentenced to 3 years in prison. After his conviction, Beechworth's Advertiser exposed him as the fizgig who betrayed Power. We have heard a great deal of Superintendent Nicholson's magnanimity in refusing the £500 reward for Power's arrest, when, in point of fact, the £500 was guaranteed in writing. There is no harm in saying it now, as the informer is secure in Pentridge. To the notorious Jack Lloyd, on condition of his putting Inspector Nicholson's hand upon the bushranger's shoulder. 3 years later, having served his time, Lloyd was released. Within weeks, his dead body was found on the road between Greta and Winton. The story was that he fell off his horse, drunk. There were rumours that he was pushed out of the saddle by a man riding beside him, but no concrete evidence ever surfaced. Stock Thieves. 5. Constable Ward. Michael Edward Ward was born in Roscommon, Ireland, on 5th of December 1845. The year that the potato blight came. The blight's arrival from North America coincided with unusually cool, wet weather that facilitated its spread. Ireland's rural poor, who subsisted on potato, watched their crops rot in the fields year after year. More than 1 million people starved to death. Many others emigrated to America, Australia, and elsewhere. Michael's family survived. They had a larger-than-average farm of about 30 acres, and his father supplemented their income at a local quarry. But life was tough for them. At the age of 20, Ward left Ireland for Tasmania. His fare on the Marco Polo was paid by a local woman named Anne Shanney of Moore. His travel documents listed his occupation as shepherd. After a short stay in Tasmania, he went to New Zealand for 2 years, then arrived in Melbourne, where he found work as a storeman. In October 1869, he enlisted as a mounted constable and was sent to Beechworth. Michael Ward is often described in history books as having a manicured, waxed mustache. This is due to a photograph taken when he was much older, decades after the events described here, when he wore spectacles and sported a well-groomed, curly mustache. Nobody actually knows what he looked like when he was young, whether he had a mustache all his life, or whether he cultivated it in later life. All that is known for certain is that he was handsome and well-groomed. He arrived in the district when Harry Power was at large with the young Ned Kelly, and was quickly assigned to a search party led by Sergeant Bose Wilson. With that patrol, he camped for days and weeks in the wilderness of a strange, unfamiliar country. Where Ireland had lush, undulating plains, northern Victoria had dry, rocky hills. Instead of green fields cut with ash tree hedgerows, here the landscape was littered with straggly eucalypt and powdery wattles. The search party never came close to finding Harry Power, who had the advantage of local knowledge and a network of allies. Wilson's patrol was ultimately sidelined by Standish's secret operation, run by Hare and Nicholson, to catch the bushranger. Ward was enlisted in another patrol 3 years later. Three men robbed a bakery, stole a gun, then shot and killed a publican with it because he refused to serve them. They fled into the bush. Under the command of Superintendent Brown, Ward and several other constables chased the murderers through the Pilot Ranges, north of Beechworth, catching them near a place called Watchbox Swamp. The scrubby mountain ranges were damp and cold in winter, but summers were blistering. During a December heatwave, while escorting a prisoner to the lockup, Ward collapsed from sunstroke. The local newspaper noted with concern, "Constable Ward is a useful officer, and the force could ill afford to lose him." Like all unmarried policemen, Ward lived in the police barracks in Beechworth, subject to police rules and regulations every hour of every day. Beds were inspected, curfews were enforced, uniforms were expected to be in good shape. He worked 8 hours a day, 7 days a week. Policemen did not even get time off to attend church. He was retained in the Ovens district, rotating through the various towns and villages, Wangaratta, Eldorado, and Greater. Most of Ward's police colleagues were Irish too, with a smattering of Scots and a few others. Australian-born men simply did not sign up. They shunned police work as a low-paid job for foreigners, and Irishmen in particular. This curious phenomenon was not unique to Victoria. The police forces of New York and Boston were, at later times, famously dominated by Irish immigrants, as were forces in Canada, Scotland, and elsewhere. The lure of police work for Irish expatriates worldwide has never been fully explained, but in the case of Victoria, it was partly because the conditions, meagre and harsh as they were superior to those for police in Ireland. Life in the Victorian police was regimented along military lines. There was an ongoing political struggle over the identity and role of the force. The previous commissioner, McMahon, preferred a quasi-military role, like the Irish Constabulary. The current commissioner, Captain Standish, and others favoured a more community-based policing style, modelled on the London Metropolitan Police, the Bobbies. The result was a mixture. McMahon had left the force, but he was now a parliamentarian and continued to impose his vision. As was typical for constables, Ward was periodically reprimanded for the usual petty infractions: being absent without leave from the barracks, not reporting when returning to the barracks, being 20 minutes late for morning stables, using insolent language to the officer in charge when an application for leave was refused. His job entailed hard work across the full range of rural Victorian life, from neighbourhood disputes to serious crime. He arrested murderers, horse thieves, burglars, and child molesters. He intervened in a dispute over the ownership of hens, caught a backyard clothesline thief, and when someone was hit by a train, he collected the strewn body parts and took them to the morgue. When a maid was charged with the theft of 2 pillows from a wealthy landowner, Ward appeared as a witness for the defence, testifying the maid had told him she was sorry she had 2 pillows in her box. When it emerged that the maid had not been paid by her employers, the case was dismissed. The job involved not just dealing with crime. He received a tip-off about an abandoned child in a bush hut near Beechworth. He and another constable broke down the door to discover an emaciated 3-year-old girl. They carefully wrapped her up and took her to Beechworth Hospital. When a little boy became lost in the bush, Ward was energetic in the search, earning praise in the news for having done yeoman's duty. The little boy was located, having fallen down a deep hole. 3 weeks later, he transported another boy who had been injured in a horse riding accident to Beechworth Hospital. On another occasion, he and another constable were assigned to catch the wild man of the woods after numerous sightings of an almost naked man brandishing a butcher's knife. They found the wild man living in a remote bush hut. He put up a fight, but they wrestled him down and took him to the Beechworth lockup, where he became quite talkative. His name was John Lee, from the south of Ireland, and after coming to Victoria, had fallen on hard times. During torrential floods on the Ovens River, word came through that some Chinese men were trapped. Ward travelled down the river with 2 local men in a boat and rescued the men from the roof of their house, delivered them to Wangaratta, then went out again to rescue 5 more people from the roof of a tobacco shed. He received a commendation for gallant conduct displayed in the rescue of several persons whose lives were imperiled by the floods. One day in Beechworth, a horse broke free of a buggy and galloped at a furious pace down the street. Michael Ward, who happened to be nearby as it charged past a bank, grabbed the reins and brought the feisty animal under control. Ward was to play a central role in the hunt for Ned Kelly and his gang, but those calamitous events were still a few years away. In the meantime, Ned's criminal career progressed, and his network of thieves and smugglers expanded, and other police suffered the brunt of his violence. Michael Ward was held in such esteem that when a senior bureaucrat lodged a complaint against him for accidentally kicking his suitcase at the station, the newspapers rallied to his cause, one stating, "Constable Ward has gained great goodwill in the discharge of duties, not always of an easy and pleasant nature, and we have no doubt that the department will consent to his receiving from his friends in Beechworth and the neighbourhood some testimony of their appreciation of him." Even Melbourne Punch took the side of the accused constable. The police department dismissed the complaint. Ward became well acquainted with Ned Kelly, Ned's brother Dan, their relatives the Quinns, and their other relatives and friends, who were all familiar faces in the district courtrooms. He let Ned off with a warning on one occasion, rather than arresting him for causing a public disturbance. In his early years as a constable, he did not arrest either of the Kelly brothers. That task fell to others, who were sometimes subjected to the Kelly's wrath in response. One Sunday in Wangaratta, Ned Kelly caused a disturbance outside a church, riding a feisty, unbroken horse. Rather than arrest him, Ward gave him a warning and told him he had better find another place for showing off his horsemanship. Kelly took the invitation literally, kicking his spurs into the animal to gallop away. But the animal bucked. Some locals believed that the embarrassing moment caused Kelly to bear a grudge against Ward from then onwards. 6. Kelly and the Cops. Even before he and Harry Power bailed up Robert McBean in March 1870, Ned Kelly had had run-ins with the law. His parents were not exemplary role models in that respect. Ned's father, John Red Kelly, had been transported to Van Diemen's Land, renamed Tasmania in 1856, for stealing 2 pigs. His 7-year sentence, of which he served 4, was probably lightened by his decision to inform on a fellow thief named Patrick Regan, who was shot by police. Given his ticket of leave in 1845, Red moved to Victoria, where he married Ellen Quinn, and took up farming and drinking. They lived in Beveridge, then Avenel, where Red was sentenced to 6 months' imprisonment for stealing a heifer. He died of alcohol-related illness in 1866. Ellen Kelly had a violent temper. In 1866, soon after Red's death, she was found guilty of verbally abusing another Avenel resident and fined £2. In early 1867, she and Red's sister, Anne Ryan, got into a physical fight. Both of them were charged, convicted of assault, and fined. 3 months later, Ellen assaulted her landlord and willfully damaged the rental property she was living in, and was fined again. After Ned was accused of stealing a horse, Ellen and her children left Avenel, possibly to avoid charges being laid. They relocated northeast to Greta, the vicinity of Ellen's dysfunctional criminal family, the Quinns. They moved in with Ellen's sisters and their children, who were renting a large old former hotel. One day, Red's brother James, recently released from jail for cattle stealing, visited the old hotel and made a pass at Ellen. She whacked him with a gin bottle, then chased him down the street with a stick. He returned and burned down the hotel. James was charged with attempted murder and sentenced to death. Redmond Barry, the judge who sentenced him, was well known for acquitting the men charged with treason after the 1854 Eureka Rebellion, and for representing Aboriginal people pro bono. He was not feeling lenient this time, however. In his summation, he made it clear it was intended as a commuted sentence, to send a message, and not an actual execution. James Kelly was never released, and died in a Melbourne lunatic asylum in 1903. Ellen purchased a nearby selection of land on 11 Mile Creek Road. Instead of farming, she made money by running a sly grog shanty and roadside inn. The Kelly shanty was a one-room hut. The rooms inside were merely partitions separated by hessian. But despite its rudimentary accommodation, it did a roaring trade with passing traffic between Melbourne and the Beechworth goldfields. Her shanty became a hangout for criminals. It was described as a groggery and gambling hell. There were multiple stories of travellers being fleeced of their cash or having their horses stolen, and of violent brawls. In 1869, when Harry Power was on the loose and being harboured by Ellen's brothers, a Chinese man named Ah Fook arrived at the Benalla police station with a note that simply said, "Kelly, 11 Mile Creek, robbed me." The note was written for him by a local who'd taken pity on Ah Fook. With the help of an interpreter, Ah Fook explained what had happened to him. He had been walking along 11 Mile Creek Road when Ned Kelly sprang out from behind a bush calling, "I'm a bush ranger. Give me your money or I'll beat you to death." Ah Fook handed over 10 shillings, but Kelly beat him up anyway. Ah Fook had the bruises to prove it. Sergeant Whalen of Benalla went to the Kelly property accompanied by another constable, Ah Fook, and an interpreter. As they approached, Ned Kelly burst out the door, sprinting away towards the back fence and the forest beyond. As Whalen galloped in pursuit, someone at the house released dogs that ran up and harassed him, slowing him down. Despite the dogs, Whalen caught Kelly, whose only remark on being arrested was that if the fence was a little nearer, he would have got away. When, back at the Kelly hut, the sergeant read out the warrant, Kelly said, "That bloody Chinaman who passed yesterday did this." He said that Ah Fook had insulted a woman at the hut, and I took a stick to him, but I never hit him. At the trial, despite the corroborating evidence of the bruises and the note, it was Ah Fook's word against Ned Kelly's. Or rather, it was Ah Fook's word against Ned Kelly, Ned's sister Annie, and two of Ned's mates, who all insisted that Ah Fook was the aggressor. They said he turned up out of the blue, demanded a glass of water, then punched Ned Kelly, who ran away and hid. After telling everyone nearby he would return to burn down the house, Ah Fook then stormed off, they claimed. Nobody believed it. Even the magistrate, A.C. Willis, indicated he didn't believe it, but he found Ned Kelly not guilty anyway. Perhaps Wills had no choice but to acquit, but he had a long record of dismissing cases where guilt was obvious and of relying on questionable witnesses to do so. 6 months after Power's capture, Ned's first serious charge was laid against him. Jeremiah and Catherine McCormick were two ex-convicts who made a living as hawkers and had camped at Greta. It had been raining hard, and the ground was boggy. One of their horses went missing, and they learned that Ned Kelly and his mate, Ben Gould, had taken it to free a bogged wagon. They retrieved the horse, but it was missing its cloth cover. When Kelly rode past, Jeremiah accused him of stealing the horse and cover, and keeping the cover. Kelly said that his uncle, Jack Lloyd, was responsible. On Sunday evening, the McCormicks were packing up their cart in Greta, covering it as protection against the rain, when they met Jack Lloyd. McCormick asked him about the horse cloth, but Lloyd said he didn't have it. Then Ned Kelly rode past again. Lloyd stopped him and demanded to know why he was telling lies. They argued. In anger and frustration, Catherine McCormick hurled a stick in Kelly's direction. Kelly wheeled his horse around and rode towards the McCormicks. Kelly shouted, "I'll ride my horse over you and kill the bloody lot of you, you bloody wretches." Then he charged his horse at Jeremiah McCormick and knocked him over. Kelly rode about 10 yards off, then turned again and shouted, "Come on, you old bugger, and fight me. I've got your cover. Do your bloody best about it. You want doing over." Later, Ned reappeared across the street. He gave something to his cousin, Tom Lloyd, and pointed at Catherine. Tom crossed the street and gave her a small parcel containing 2 bullock's testicles and an obscene note saying, "Your husband can tie them to his cock so he can shag you better next time." Kelly departed, but the McCormicks were terrified that he would return. Jeremiah sat by his wagon with a loaded revolver late into the night, until he eventually decided to seek protection from the police. Edward Hall was a burly, overweight but tough constable from Ireland who had been assigned to the Greta station in August. Within weeks of Hall's arrival, Pat Quinn, one of Ned's uncles, had beaten him unconscious with a stirrup iron in the Greta police yard. McCormick showed Constable Hall the note Kelly had given his wife. He said he was afraid to press charges against Kelly, but Hall persuaded the McCormicks to accompany him to Wangaratta Courthouse the next day, where Jeremiah made a sworn statement that he was in fear of his life. On the basis of that statement, Hall charged Kelly with assault and using obscene language. At the Wangaratta Police Court, Kelly was sentenced to 6 months' hard labour, 3 for the assault and 3 for the obscene note. For the successful arrest and conviction of Ned Kelly, Hall was commended and was given a £5 bonus. In his report on the matter, Hall revealed that he had learned that Ned Kelly had been trying to obtain firearms and was planning to take to the bush with a man named Billy Cook, previously known as Alan Lowry. He had changed his name after his recent release from Pentridge Prison, who would soon arrive in the district. Hall concluded, therefore, that putting Kelly behind bars will save the police a good deal of trouble over the summer months. Ned Kelly served 4 months of his 6-month sentence. Soon after his release, Constable Hall learned from an informer, a horse thief named James Murdoch, that Kelly had been boasting that the horse he was riding was stolen. A few days earlier, a horsebreaker from Mansfield named Isaiah Wright, known to all as Wild Wright, had lodged at the Kelly shanty. Wright was a tall, strapping horse thief from Mansfield, about 40 miles south of Greta.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.